Hi, beautiful people. How are ya? I hope you're having a great day.
With you, I can be sad with you. Just take my hand and fly up through the dreams where the skies are so clear.
I'm settling into my new routine. I've got Tesla in his bed down here, and I have Lucy in her bed down here. I moved Lucy's bed a little closer to me, and I think she's enjoying it. She seems happy with the change. Although I don't like a lot of change, some change is good, just not too much for me all at once. I've been wanting to find a place for that picture back there for quite a while. It's been moved all over my house. And sometimes you just need a change. So I changed it up a little bit back there and then over here. It makes me smile. That's a picture of, well, what I think of as Venice and the water canals there. I've never been overseas, but I can dream, can't I? Apparently, Venice is experiencing a drought right now, and so the gondolas and water taxis can't conduct business. And surprisingly, in 2019, they were experiencing flooding. Still, I can walk through this room and look up there at that picture and put a smile on my face. But on to our topic today. Like most things in life, we can have too much or not enough of an important mineral in our body. We need minerals to support good health. Iodine is no exception. Thank you to my sub who brought up iodine in a post. She found her cold feet were due to her iodine deficiency. And I thought that really interesting. So I was hot on the trail of research. I mean, together we can learn. So let's begin our discussion with the history of iodine in research and the importance of iodine and iodine deficiency, about fibromyalgia and chronic pain, and lastly, having too much iodine. Here we go. One of the main roles of iodine is to help manufacture thyroid hormones. With the desire to eat healthy, many people have stopped adding iodized salt in their food and use sea salt instead. I love sea salt, but it doesn't contain the amount of iodine that we need on a daily basis. But a problem arose around 2011. Goiter started to recur in people, and iodine deficiency became a problem once again. You see, before iodized salt became available in the 1920s, the U.S. had a goiter belt around the Great Lakes region and the Northwest region of this country. It was a medical emergency. Once iodized salt became available, goiters became a thing of the past. A French chemist was the first to publish a paper on iodine deficiency as the cause of goiter around 1851. It was met with skepticism, and local physicians said that drunkenness, dampness, poor hygiene, and contaminated water was the cause of goiter. So they took down trees and cleaned up the streets. Eventually, they gave iodized salt tablets to children who were having problems with goiters. And 80% of the 5,000 children were cured or improved. But there was another problem, myxedema. This is a lack of activity of the thyroid from untreated hypothyroidism as we know it today. It's rare, but life-threatening. One cause is iodine deficiency. So in 1896, the link between goiter, myxedema, and iodine was established. In 1915, Switzerland's iodized salt program began by administering minute quantities of iodine to children with goiter. It was a success. Iodized salt had spectacular results with newborns who had goiters, and they disappeared. No new cretins, which is from fetal or early life thyroid deficiency, were born, and goiters in children were reduced. At about the same time, iodine studies were occurring in the U.S. between 1915 and 1919 because of the goiter issues in the Midwest. The first treatment study was in Akron, Ohio, and after treatment, none of them had goiter. Michigan added iodized salt in 1924. Pregnant women and those lactating were also recommended iodine supplementation. In 1948, all states introduced iodized salt by federal law. Eventually, between 1970 and 1990 in the U.S., programs against iodine deficiency disorders began. The incidence of cretinism, or what we now call congenital hypothyroidism, was eliminated, and cognitive function improved in the remaining population. Today, researchers continue to study the links between deficient and excess iodine intake and the epidemiology of thyroid diseases, interactions of iodine deficiency disorders, and other micronutrient deficiencies, as well as molecular mechanisms. Today, about one-third of the world's population is thought to be iodine deficient, and U.S. numbers are thought to be higher. Quote, iodide is an essential component of the thyroid hormones, T3 and T4, which are required for development and maturation of the central nervous system, skeletal muscle, and lungs of the fetus and the newborn, and for intermediary metabolism in virtually all tissues, unquote. Today, we get most of our iodine in table salt. We've discussed iodized salt, but did you know that until recently, about 25% of the iodine in our diet was from wheat because iodine was used in the process of making flour? Now, the chemical cousin of iodine, called bromide or bromate, is used to make the dough rise higher and gives the loaf a better appearance. It's believed that bromide blocks the activity of iodine, which is also true of chlorine and fluoride, common in drinking water. Bromide or bromate is legal to use in the U.S., even though Canada and the U.K. have banned it, since it's a class 2B carcinogen. So table salt with added iodine appears to be used less in the home. You can see why this is a problem. So look for breads that don't have bromide or bromate in them. So let's talk about bromide for a moment. This is enlightening. Bromide is an environmental toxin and an endocrine disruptor. Like fluoride, the most serious side effect is what it can do to your thyroid function. It competes with iodine in cellular sites, including the thyroid and mammary glands, among other sites, making it a risk factor for breast cancer and cancers of the reproductive and endocrine systems. Because it can deplete the body of iodine, it can lead to hypothyroidism. It can also cause premature births, cognitive issues, kidney damage, loss of hearing, We need healthy amounts of sodium and potassium. And cancer. Cancer is connected to potassium bromate, which is added to bread products. So even though bromate is not banned in the U.S., it has at least been labeled a carcinogen by the IARC, International Agency for the Research on Cancer. And a disclaimer, if you have heart failure or high blood pressure, follow medical advice. I'm not here to tell you to add salt to your diet, so make sure you find a safe way to add iodine if you need it. Even people with high blood pressure need a fair amount of iodine or salt. Adults need about 500 milligrams of salt every day and 150 micrograms of iodine every day. So completely removing salt is a bad idea. Usually just eliminating eating out or buying fast food is enough to reduce your salt intake. Some people are more sensitive to salt than others, like African Americans, the elderly, and people with diabetes. So discuss this with your doctor. Since 2001, iodine intake dropped by 50%, but it isn't continuing to drop, fortunately. Our body requires iodine for healthy cellular and metabolic functioning. Not only is iodine important for the production of thyroid, but it's also responsible for the production of all the other hormones in the body and improves immune function. According to Dr. David Brownstein, I put a link below to the website. He's written many books, and there's several interviews on YouTube. He's a holistic doctor, so you decide. Iodine is the most misunderstood nutrient. You shouldn't fear salt or iodine. And in Japan, get much more iodine in their diets compared to Americans. So they have a 65% lower risk of breast cancer. And lower levels of iodine may increase the risk of heart disease. Iodine can be found in fish, dairy, Greek yogurt, oysters, eggs, iodized salt, liver, and seaweed, or taken as a supplement. Supplements are usually in the form of potassium iodide or sodium iodide, and supplements containing iodine kelp or seaweed are also available. I found the following interesting too. Soy and cruciferous vegetables like cabbage, broccoli, cauliflower, and Brussels sprouts, some of my favorite vegetables, can interfere with the way the body uses iodine. But eating a reasonable amount of these veggies is not a concern. Iodine deficiency is associated with a plethora of illnesses, including ADHD, breast, thyroid, ovarian, and uterine cancer, detoxification, fatigue, fibrocystic breasts, Graves' disease, Hashimoto's disease, and hypothyroidism. But here's the kicker. If you get too much iodine in your body, it can cause the same symptoms as iodine deficiency, such as goiter, thyroid gland inflammation, and thyroid cancer. It's always about balance. Iodine can also interact with medications like meds used to treat hyperthyroidism and high blood pressure. So do your own research and talk to your doctor. Other symptoms of low iodine are weight gain, fatigue and weakness, thinning hair, dry skin, feeling colder than usual, slowed heart rate, and learning and memory problems. Females may also experience heavy or irregular periods. Here's a quote from Psychology Today. Low iodine might also contribute to fatigue and chronic fatigue syndrome. A study showed that people with low body temperature and fatigue felt better and had more energy when they took a daily supplement of 1500 micrograms MCG of iodine. The RDA is 150. Though their temperature didn't rise, it's reasonable for those with unexplained fatigue, chronic fatigue syndrome, or fibromyalgia to add an iodine supplement of 6 to 12 milligrams daily for 3 months to see if it helps. You'll often see a marked increase in energy within the first month, unquote. Most drugstores have this supplement at 500 micrograms per tablet, or MCGs, or 12.5 mg, milligrams, which is the high potency amount suggested in this article. Because I have neurocardiogenic syncope, or NCS, I need salt. I can tell when I don't have enough. I salt my foods with iodized salt. I tried using sea salt. I just didn't feel like I got the same effect. Maybe it's also the iodine that I need, but either way, I'm not afraid to salt my food. I don't have high blood pressure. With NCS, my blood pressure is low, so no worries there. But this is my experience. What's yours? I'm thinking about trying the 12.5 milligrams of iodine for 3 months and see how I feel. Just one more thing to add to my arsenal. But taking high doses of iodine over a long period of time could change the way your thyroid glands work. Right now, my thyroid is working fine, so I don't want to upset that chemistry either. So I think that may be the reason it's suggested to try for 3 months and see how you feel. But it would be wise to work with your doctor if you're thinking of adding a high dose of iodine to your diet. In addition, GI upset, nausea, vomiting, and diarrhea can occur. And then that can lead to delirium, stupor, and shock. But it's rarely fatal. As always, there are extremes in every case. So as long as we're careful and pay attention to our symptoms, I think we'll be good. So I hope you enjoyed this video, and I hope you learned something. I did. I send you gentle hugs and support. Love you.
With you, I can be sad with you.
About fibromyalgia and chronic and iodine deficiency, goiter started to recur in people, and it's with newborn goiters, newborn, those who were born with goiters from, because it can deplete the bulk, is enough to reduce your iodine can also interact for
it's been so cold.